students, today we are going to start with current electricity. So what is current electricity? Each one of you, you must have got a shock sometimes in your life. If not, it is just a wave of irritability when you get a shock. Like for example, if you touch a metal surface, supposing it's a metal surface, you get a shock. That means you are a conductor and the electrons flow through us. That means that's the movement of n number of electrons. That's charge. So whenever you get a shock, that means the charge flows through you. Now you move your hand immediately. That means it also depends on time. So what is current? Current is the flow of charge moving through you per unit time. Just see the formula. Current, it is the flow of charge per unit time. I is equal to Q upon T is equal to Ne upon time. N means number of electrons. Now, what are the unit of current, charge and time? See, unit of charge is coulomb, unit of current is ampere, unit of time is second. So, what is current? Current is N number of electrons flowing through you or charge per unit time. Okay, so now, next thing what you need to know is the conversion, the units. These are very, very important. One millicoulomb is equal to 10 raised to minus 3 coulomb. 1 microcoulomb is 10 raised to minus 6 coulomb. 1 nanocoulomb is 10 raised to minus 9 coulomb. Same way, 1 milliampere is 10 raised to minus 3 ampere. 1 microampere is 10 raised to minus 6 ampere. Okay, so now look at this. This is the wire. Okay, and now this wire is no longer conducting. It's just a wire. So the electrons are moving in any direction. But once these electrons are connected to a battery, then the electricity starts flowing. Can you see how the movement of the current is? Movement of the current is from positive to negative. And how is the movement of the electrons? Just see, movement of the electrons is from negative to positive. See, this small line means negative. Big line means positive. So how is the electrons moving? Negative to positive. And how is the electric current moving? From positive to negative. So that is how we get a shock. That means N number of electrons flows through you. Now, what is potential difference? Now, you must be knowing that when you accidentally or someone accidentally touch the electricity pole, there more current is passing through. You can get a bigger shock. A person can die over there. But at home, less amount of current flows. That's why you get a minor shock. But of course, you have to have a safety guard. Like for example, whenever you're handling electrical appliances, you have to wear chappals, shoes and all. And you have to have gloves and all when you're handling electrical gadgets and all. So you have to be very careful with that. Now, what is this heavy current and less current? It all depends on potential difference. Okay, now what is potential difference? Now like for example, if you have water stored in the overhead tanker, okay, in your building, overhead tanker is there. So there is a water stored and there is lots of water stored. Then how is the water coming in the tap? It will be gushing, right? Now what happens if the water in the tank becomes less or it is very, very less? Then the water in the tap will also be slow. So same way, the potential difference is more, then current is more. And if the potential difference is less, then the current is less. Okay, so potential difference is, actually speaking, it is the cell or the battery. Like for example, if you put 2-3 batteries, then the work done will be faster. Okay, now that is a further topic. We'll come across that later. But then potential difference is, actually speaking, is the cell. Okay, we'll be studying that in detail later on. But then the definition in the textbook is different. You have to learn the definition. So what is the definition which they have given in the textbook? First, potential at a point. Okay, potential at a point. It is the amount of work done per unit charge in bringing a unit positive charge to that point. Amount of work done in bringing a unit charge from infinity to that point. And potential difference, it is the amount of work done per unit charge in moving a positive charge from one point to another. Okay, so just as you have current is equal to Q upon T, potential difference V is equal to W upon Q. How much work is done per unit charge? Okay, just remember this. Potential difference is work done per unit time. So now the unit of potential difference is volt. Okay, what is the unit of potential difference? Volt. Unit of work is joules. Unit of charge is coulomb. So then when is it said to be 1 volt?
when work, 1 joule of work is done per unit coulomb. Okay, so when 1 joule of work is done per unit coulomb, the work done is said to be 1 volt. Are you understanding? So that is potential difference. Okay, there are many more examples of potential difference. I just gave you about the overhead tank. Another example is about heat always flows from a higher level to a lower level. Then you have supposing an object is there, I'm holding some object, and if I release it, it always falls down. That means from higher level to lower level. The electricity always moves from positive to negative. Current electricity moves from positive. Positive is said to be higher level. If you see a cell, okay, a pencil cell, the positive is on top, negative is down. The electricity flows from positive to negative. So that is potential difference. So I guess you have all understood about potential difference. Just go through it, all of the formulas, write down the definitions, okay, learn it as we are going further, okay. If you see the description box, in that there is a link provided, in that there are notes also of whatever we have done over here. So go through those important notes, okay. So the next thing what we are going to study is, of course, this current and potential difference is a scalar quantity. Then then next is resistance. Now what is resistance? Resistance is the obstruction to the flow of current. Now, like for example, whenever electricity flows through this wire, and this wire is a good conductor, that means there is a less obstruction, okay, less resistance. Like for example, when you are traveling on a highway, so how fast the car moves on a highway, but if there is lots of crowd, okay, the car is moving in a market, so there are a lot of people, so you cannot drive the car fast. So same way, resistance is the obstruction to the flow of current. So thicker the wire, less is the resistance. So there are actually 4 factors on which resistance depend on. Okay, so resistance is the obstruction of the flow of current. The unit of resistance is ohm. Okay, and the formula for resistance is V is equal to IR. That means potential difference is directly proportional to current, and if you remove the proportionality, it becomes V is equal to IR. So this is actually Ohm's law. Okay, so we are going to study Ohm's law. So Ohm's law, the current flowing in a conductor is directly proportional to potential difference. The current is directly proportional to the potential difference across its ends, provided that the physical conditions and the temperature of the conductor remains constant. So physical conditions, that means wire size and of the wire and all, and temperature should remain constant. If the physical condition and temperature is constant, then potential difference is directly proportional to the current. That's Ohm's law. Okay, then later on the formula V is equal to IR, and the unit of resistance is said to be 1 ohm. So now, like for example, when is it said to be 1 ohm? So see, R is equal to V upon I, unit of volt is, unit of potential difference is volt, unit of current is ampere. So whenever 1 volt of work is done, okay, potential difference 1 volt is provided, and when the current is 1 ampere flowing through it. So that is the definition for 1 ohm. So a resistance of a conductor is 1 ohm if 1 ampere current flows through it when a potential difference of 1 volt is applied across its end. Okay, now you also have to remember certain conversion. 1 kilo ohm is 10 raised to kilo ohm is 10 raised to 3 ohm. 1 mega ohm is equal to 10 raised to 6 ohm. And in the resistance, you need to remember this. Then you know what is conductance? Conductance is the reciprocal of resistance. So the definition of conductance, it is the reciprocal of resistance, and the unit is ohm minus 1 or 1 upon ohm. Okay, so as the unit of resistance is ohm, unit of potential difference conductance is ohm minus 1. It's also called Siemens. So conductance unit is ohm minus 1 or Siemens. Okay, now next is the IV graph. Okay, the IV graph of ohmic and non-ohmic conductors. So IV graph is always a straight line. See here, this is I and this is V. The resistance is straight line. So IV graft. So so then IV. So I upon V is equal to I upon R. So the ratio of this gives the reciprocal of resistance. I upon V is equal to 1 upon R. Just remember this, IV graph is like this. Okay, got it? Then what is the limitation of the Ohm's law? I said that the physical condition and temperature should remain constant. Okay, then next is the ohmic and non. We have studied about Ohm's law. So Ohm's law, V is equal to IR, that means current is directly proportional to voltage. But not all the gadgets, or we can say not all the appliances or not all the things follow Ohm's law. There are some which do not follow Ohm's law. So accordingly, there are some appliances which are known as ohmic conductors. Some of them are called non-ohmic conductors. So if you see the graph, VI graph of ohmic conductors. So VI graph of ohmic conductor, if you see, it's a straight line. Can you see? VI, this is a straight line of graph, and this slope is called as resistance. So the VI graph of ohmic conductors is a straight line, whereas the ohmic graph, non-ohmic conductors ka graph, is always a curved line. Okay, so now ohmic conductors always obey the Ohm's law, and non-ohmic conductors do not follow Ohm's law. The graph is a straight line. The graph, VI graph of ohmic conductor is always straight line, whereas the graph of non-ohmic conductors is a curved line. Then all metallic conductors, then you have like for example silver, iron, copper, nichrome, electrolyte, these are all ohmic conductors. And over here, non-ohmic conductors may junction diode, LED, transistors, filament of a bulb. Now just remember the distinguish between ohmic conductors and non-ohmic conductors. Now what are good conductors? Good conductors means the metals which conduct electricity, in which there are very less resistance. Okay, I gave you the ohmic conductors. So these are large electrons which are flowing through you, through the wire. Okay, now insulators are the one in which there are no electrons whatsoever. Like for example, you on top of a wire you have this coating, plastic coating, that those are insulators. Okay, insulator means no current. So if supposing if insulated wire is taken, you don't get a shock. Okay, unless and until you open it. Okay, remove the insulation. Now look at this verification of Ohm's law. This is a circuit diagram. Although this is not coming for exam, but this is very important for further studies. Just see the position of potential difference, current, resistance and all of that. So now over here, this is the battery. Okay, the battery, this is the positive. The long line is the positive, the small line is the negative. See how the electrons are moving from positive to negative. This is the resistance. The voltmeter is always connected in parallel with the resistance. See the ammeter. Ammeter is always connected in series of the circuit. See, ammeter is connected in series. This will be helpful for you to understand the numericals also. So voltmeter is connected with the parallel with the resistance. Ammeter is connected in series, and this is the rheostat. Rheostat can increase or decrease the current. So when you increase the rheostat, the current decreases, and vice versa. Like for example, you have the fan regulator. So when you increase the speed of the fan, what happens, you know, this current decreases, and when the current decreases, the fan goes faster. Okay, less the resistance, more the current, that way. Okay, so just go through this nicely. This will be this diagram is not coming, but it will be helpful for you for solving the numericals. Okay, so now the next thing what we are going to do is okay, resistance. I told you the resistance depends on factors. Like for example, thicker the wire, less is the resistance. I have told you before. Okay, like for example, you have a highway, and when the highway is empty, so the cars move very fast. So same way, if the wire is thick, the electrons move very fast. Okay, they don't hit against the sides and all. Okay, so that's why thicker the wire, less is the resistance. So let's study all the factors on which resistance depend on. So resistance depends on four factors. Which are the four factors? It depends upon the nature of the conductor, what type of wire it is. like different wires are there. Like for example, you have copper wire at home. Of course, silver has the least resistance, but we do not use silver because it's really expensive. Okay, then next is nichrome wire. You know where nichrome wire is used? It is used in heater. Okay, why? Because it has high resistance and very high melting point. That's why nichrome is used. Then you know bulbs, tungsten wire is used. Tungsten wire is used because that also has a high melting point and high resistance. But specific material for specific purposes they use. So different materials are used. So they come under resistance. Okay. So resistance depends on the nature of conductor. It depends on area of cross section. It is in fact inversely proportional. That means thicker the wire, less is the resistance. It depends on the temperature. More the temperature, more the resistance. Okay. So and also it also depends on the length of the wire. Okay. More the length, more is the resistance. So I'll write it down. Okay. Factors of resistance. So first factor is the nature of wire. Then second is area of cross section. Now this is directly proportion. Okay. Area of cross section is inversely. Then third is length. So this is directly. Then last one is temperature. This is also directly. So nature of the wire, that means what quality wire it is. Area of cross section, that means the thickness of the wire, it is inversely proportional. Length, it is directly proportional. Temperature, it is directly proportional. So these are the four factors on which resistance depends on. Now resistance, as I have told you, it's inversely proportional to the area of cross section. So resistance is inversely proportional to the area of cross section. Now wire ka area of cross section means it's a circle, so it's pi r square. So 1 upon pi r square. So resistance is inversely proportional to the square of the radius. Radius means thickness. Okay, so now if supposing if the radius is increased 2 times. So if the radius is increased 2 times, radius twice. Okay, I'm writing in short. Radius twice. So area of cross section becomes what? It becomes 4 times. Okay, you know why 4 times? Instead of r you put 2, 2 square is 4, and resistance becomes 1 upon 4 times. Did you get it? So there are some application questions like this. Just keep it in mind. Okay, specific resistance. Specific resistance is what? Now specific resistance is the resistance for unit length and unit area of cross section. Now it may be a little difficult for you to remember, but just remember the formula. R is equal to rho L upon A. Now just see the definition first of all. It is the resistance of a wire of that material of unit length and unit area of cross section. R is equal to rho L upon A. Now rho stands for sigma, that is specific resistance. So when you take L as 1 and A as 1, what will happen to resistance? Resistance is equal to resistivity. So that's exactly the definition what they have made. So it is the resistance of a wire of that material of unit length and unit area of cross section. Okay, so what is resistance? Resistivity. Resistivity is equal to resistance for unit length and unit area of cross section. Okay, now what are the factors on which resistivity depends on? Resistivity depends on material and temperature. It is independent of the shape and size of the conductor. You know, resistance depends on the shape and size of the conductor, but resistivity does not depend on shape and size of the conductor. So factors depends on material, independent depends on material, depends on temperature, independent of shape and size of the conductor. Now what is conductivity? Conductivity is the reciprocal of resistivity. So the unit of conductivity is 1 upon ohm meter or siemen per meter. Now you know what is the unit of specific resistance? It is ohm meter. Okay, now just see the VI graph, and these are the two slopes which they have given. There is one conductor whose slope is A and another conductor whose slope is B. You have to find out which one has high resistance and which one has high temperature. So the one which is having more slope is the one which is having high resistance and high temperature. B has less slope, so less resistance and less temperature. C, A steeper, more resistance. C, A steeper, more temperature and more resistance. Keep this in mind, this comes in application question. B, less temperature and less resistance. Okay, now we are going to study more about resistivity. Okay, now you know resistivity is very very important when they ask application question based on it. Now we have studied about the resistance and area of cross section. Resistance is inversely proportional to the area of cross section. That means resistance is inversely proportional to R square. Okay, now that is when the length of the conductor is fixed. Whenever you are taking 2-3 conductors and the length is fixed, then that time only we have to consider that formula. But supposing the length is varying, like for example, just look at this. Supposing this is the length of the wire, this is the area of cross section, this is the resistance. Now if the wire is stretched to double its length, that's when specific resistance come. Wire is stretched twice to length, area of cross section becomes half and resistance becomes 4 times. Okay, now imagine you have a rubber band. When you stretch the rubber band to double its length, how will the thickness vary? Thickness will become half or no? That's why area of cross section becomes half and the resistance becomes 4 times. That means the wire becomes thinner. So wire becomes thinner, that means resistance increases. And how about if supposing the length is becomes 3 times, area of cross section becomes 1/3, resistance becomes 9 times. Whatever is in front of L, just square it. Okay, now what happens if you fold the wire? So length becomes half, area of cross section becomes 2a and resistance becomes 1/4 times. I told you whatever is in front of L, square it. So what is in front of L? 1/2. Square of that is 1/4. So resistance becomes 1/4 times. And if you fold the rubber band, then what happens? It will look thicker, right? So that is 2a. And what happens if you fold it 3 times? Length becomes L/3. Area of cross section becomes 3a. Resistance becomes 1/9 times. Alright, just remember that. So that is how the resistivity or specific resistance depend on. Okay. So now we will study about different conductors. Okay, so like for example, copper wire is used for electricity wires. Then they are using nichrome for heater. Then for electric bulb, they are using tungsten. Then for resistance, you know what is resistance? Resistors are used in electronic devices. Okay, resistance and resistors are little different. Okay, so they are not exactly the same. So what are resistors? Resistors are used in electronic appliances. They are actually made up of an alloy. Okay, and their name is constantan and magnanin. What is the specialty of resistors? Whenever the temperature increases or decreases, the resistance remains fixed. Okay, so you know now, when the temperature increases, resistance increases, and when the temperature decreases, resistance decreases. But then these resistors are made of such a material in which when the temperature increases or decreases, resistance remains fixed. Same way, there is another type of conductor that is called a superconductor. Now what are superconductors? Superconductors are conductors in which resistance becomes zero or negligible at low temperature. Okay, so see, superconductors, resistance is zero at very low. Example, tin and lead, mercury and niobium. Learn the example, huh? Tin and lead is used for making superconductors, and mercury and niobium is used for making superconductors. Resistor, alloy magnesium and constantan in use. Okay, they have fixed resistance at low or high temperature. Okay, you know that all. Then there are other materials also. Have you heard about semiconductors? Now semiconductors are conductors in which resistance decreases when the temperature increases. Okay, so you like some material for electronic devices in which as the temperature increases, resistance decreases. Okay, like for example, in once upon a time, all the places where computers were kept, the temperature used to be very low, And so the scientists used to say that for a computer to work efficiently, the temperature should be very low. But now when semiconductors came, it is nothing like that. This computer can work well in Africa also, and without light also. So like ATM centers, it is not necessary that ATM centers should have AC. You know, most of the time on most of the places, ATM centers have AC because that's a superconductor working over there. It's connected to the net and all. But then without AC also, ATM center can work. That's because of semiconductors. So what are semiconductors? Semiconductors have low resistance at high temperature. For example, carbon, silicon and germanium. Okay, then fuse wire. You know, the fuse wire at the beginning, at the entrance, you have the fuse meter box. In that meter box, there is a fuse. Okay, so a fuse is made up of an alloy of tin and lead. Remember that fuse is an alloy of tin and 50% tin, 50% lead. So it has high resistance, low melting point. So as soon as high current flows, the fuse blows off and protects the appliance from getting damaged. Okay, but nowadays you have miniature circuit breaker. We'll be studying more about miniature circuit breaker in household electricity. Okay, so now next thing what we are going to study is about EMF, internal resistance, terminal voltage and the factors on which it depends on. We are going to study about EMF. Now what is EMF? Now I have told you before that EMF in layman's language means a cell. You know what is inside a cell? There are electrodes, there is an electrolyte. Okay, so now EMF over here means the same thing. Now do you know what is the difference between a cell and a battery? You must have heard about cell and you must have heard about battery also. Now many cells make up a battery. Okay, now the cell that we use at home is usually 1.5 volt. It's fixed standard. The voltage is 1.5 volt. The pencil cell that you use in the clock, then various places, remote control and all of TV, that all the voltage of that cell is always 1.5 volt. Now what is EMF according to the textbook or the definition in the textbook? So EMF is equal is the potential difference when the circuit is open, that is when current is not drawn from the cell. Now look at this electrolyte, look at this circuit diagram over here. So this is an EMF, this is a cell, okay, and it's connected to internal resistance over here, and this is a key, okay, this is a key. See how the current is moving. See, current is moving from positive over like that round. This is the resistance and the voltmeter is connected in the parallel to the circuit. Okay. So now EMF is what? EMF is the potential difference when the circuit is open. See, this key is open. Okay, when the key is open, EMF is the potential difference when the circuit is open and when no current is drawn. When this key is open, then no current is drawn. That's why it is called as EMF. So EMF, when no current is drawn from the cell, that is when the cell is open circuit, the potential difference between a terminal of a cell is called EMF. Now what are the factors in which EMF depend on? Now EMF depends upon the nature of the electrodes and the electrolyte used. That is material of the electrode and electrolyte used. What type of electrolyte it is. Okay, so it depends on the electrolyte and material of the electrode. We studied about active electrodes, inert electrode in chemistry, right? So what is the material of the electrode and electrolyte? These are the factors on which EMF depend on. Now EMF does not depend on shape and size of the electrode, distance between the electrodes, amount of electrolyte in the cell. Okay, how much electrolyte is used, whether you are using more or less, it does not depend upon the amount of electrolyte used. Then what is terminal voltage? Terminal voltage is the potential difference when the circuit is closed. Now supposing I close this key, okay, when I close this key, means current starts moving round. Before, in EMF case, the current was not moving because it was open circuit. Okay, so when the circuit is closed, when the current is drawn from the cell, the terminal voltage is equal to the potential difference. Now, see the definition, terminal voltage. When the current is drawn from the cell, that is when the cell is closed circuit, the potential difference across the terminal of a cell is called terminal voltage. Now, EMF is always greater than the terminal voltage. Okay, now EMF depends on potential difference or terminal voltage plus drop in potential. EMF depends on terminal voltage plus drop in potential. There is a little drop in voltage because of the resistance inside the cell. There is resistance outside also and inside the cell also. So because of the resistance which is inside the cell, there is a drop in potential. Okay, and that is called potential drop or internal drop in, or internal resistance. Okay, drop in the potential because of internal resistance. Now the voltage drop, work done per unit charge in carrying the positive test charge through the electrolyte is called the voltage drop of a cell. Remember the definition of voltage drop. That means the voltage drop taking place inside the cell because of the internal resistance. Okay, so work done per unit charge when positive charge is moving through the electrolyte. Now internal resistance, the resistance offered by the electrolyte inside the cell is called internal resistance. Okay, remember the internal resistance, the resistance inside the cell. Okay, EMF is equal to terminal voltage plus drop in potential. Drop in potential is given by I into small r. Small r is the internal resistance. Now, what is the factor on which internal resistance depends on? So, internal resistance depends on various factors. There are four factors on which internal resistance depend. So, internal resistance depends on the distance between the electrode, nature of the electrode, electrolyte use and the temperature of the electrolyte. So I'll write it down quickly, the factors on which the internal resistance depends on. So internal resistance depends on the surface area of the electrode, it is inversely proportional. Then second point, it depends on distance between the electrodes. That's inside the cell. Inside the cell we have electrodes, electrolyte. Distance between the electrodes, it is directly proportional. Learn this. Third is the nature and concentration of the electrolyte. Nature and concentration of the electrolyte. Okay, this is a direct proportion. And the fourth one is temperature of the electrolyte. Okay, so these are the factors on which internal resistance depend on. Now we are going to study about resistance in series and resistance in parallel. So what is resistance in series? Now look at this. These three resistance are in series. We can call it R1, R2, R3. And this resistance are in parallel. Okay. This is R1, R2. Okay. So this is current I. This is becomes I1, I2, I. Okay. So whenever the resistance are connected in series, we can say that RS is equal to R1 plus R2 plus RN. So whenever the resistance are connected in series, you have to add all the resistance. Okay, and here when they are connected in parallel, what you do? 1 upon RP is equal to 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2 plus 1 upon RN. So over here, whenever the resistance are connected in series, the resistance add up, and what else? The current remains the same. Current remains the same. Over here the current remains the same. How much ever is the current over here, here, everywhere the current will remain the same. And here the current varies. Current varies. Very important. When you check the current over here, it will be I1. When you check over the current at R2 resistor, the current will be different. So I1, I2, I have written two different current, because when it is connected in series, the I current remains the same. Okay. But here, whenever they are connected in parallel, the current drops, or we can say the current changes. Okay. Now over here, the voltage drops. Okay. Here the voltage drops. Here voltage you will see different, here voltage you see different, here you will see different voltage. But here the voltage remains the same. Whatever voltage is over here, the same voltage is observed over here. So I can say the voltage across the resistance remains same. Okay, just remember this difference between current resistance in series and resistance in parallel. So whenever the resistance are in series, you have to add all the resistance, the current remains the same, voltage drops. And whenever the resistance are connected in parallel, the current changes, the voltage remains the same, and the resistance, of course, it becomes less. Okay, so that is resistance in series, resistance in parallel. Okay, now there are a formula, there is a formula for this. Okay, these all formulas, Rs is equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3 plus plus Rn. This is very important, and this formula for parallel, this is also very important. Now remember, there is a formula when the two resistance are connected in parallel. So you can find out I1, okay, the current I1. When you have all the values, you can find out I1. The formula I'll write down over here. So see, I1 is equal to I into R2, R1 plus R2. Remember the formula. Okay, I1 is equal to I into R2, R1 plus R2. And if you want to find out I2, I minus I1. Okay, so these two formulas are very, very important. First is the whenever the current is flowing through parallel circuit, and you have to find out I1, the two current it changes. So I1, if you want to find out, I1 is equal to I into R2, R1 plus R2, and I2 is equal to I minus I1. The formula is given over here. Please go through it. Okay, so now we are going to study the formulas related to work done by electrical appliances and the power. Okay, and we are going to study some of the few important sums which we are going to study the later on. Okay, few sums, I'll just give you an idea behind those sums. Now we are going to study about electrical energy. We use many appliances at home. As soon as you finish your school, when you come home, you ring the bell. Okay, so when you ring the bell, what happens? Electrical energy gets converted into sound energy. Then maybe you go and switch the geyser on. So geyser on means electrical energy to heat energy. Then maybe you switch on the light. Then electrical energy into light energy, and of course heat energy if you are using incandescent bulb. Then inverter is at work. So inverter, what happens? Electrical energy gets converted to chemical energy, and chemical energy gets converted to electrical energy. And when you switch on the fan, electrical energy gets converted to wind energy, that is mechanical energy. So forth and so forth. So many energy conversion can take place at home because of electrical energy. That is the reason why using electrical energy. So it is based on the law of conservation of energy. Energy can neither be created nor destroyed, but can be transferred from one form to another. Now whatever electricity you are using, you are getting a bill for it. Every month the electrician comes from the government, and he checks up the meter which are there outside your house. The meter box is there, a kilowatt hour meter. That is the electrical energy, how it is measured. One unit is a kilowatt hour. And he takes down the reading, and then he sends the so every month the electrician comes, notes down the reading of the meter, and then sends you the bill. Now how is this electricity bill been measured? What is the formula for it? That's what we are going to study over here. But before that, whenever we are using any appliance, electrical appliance, work is said to be done, and that work is given by W is equal to QV, charge into voltage. Now if you substitute Q is equal to IT, when you substitute Q is equal to IT, the formula turns V is equal VIT. Okay, now if you substitute instead of V IR, then we get I square RT, and instead of I, if you put substitute V upon R, we get V square R upon T. So just learn the formula. W is equal to QV is equal to VIT is equal to I square RT is equal to V square R upon T. Okay, that's the way how you get these formulas. Okay, yeah, or you can just learn work done is equal to VIT, and with the help of this you can get the formula. Like for example, if you want everything in current and resistance, you don't want voltage, then instead of V put IR, so it becomes I square RT. Now if you don't want current in it, so instead of current you put V upon T, and you get V square R upon T. Depending upon whatever is given in the question, in the numericals, and whatever is asked, accordingly you have to use the formula. Now power is work upon time. Work is VIT, right? So substitute VIT, T get cancelled, so VI, then V is equal to IR. When you substitute that, I square R, and when you substitute instead of I, V upon R, we get V square upon R. So that's how these all formulas are interlinked. So you can learn one formula, and when you need the rest of them, you can make on your own. Like just learn power is equal to VI and W is equal to VIT. Now unit of work you already studied in the earlier lesson, work power energy. So joule, kilojoules, and kilowatt hour. Kilowatt hour is the unit of electricity, measurement of electricity by the electrician. Okay, then watt hour definition. 1 watt hour is the electrical energy consumed by an electrical appliance of power 1 watt where it is used for 1 hour. So 1 watt hour is equal to 3600 joules. Now 1 watt hour, why, how does it come 3600? Because R means 60 into 60 second, so that is 3600 joules. Kilowatt hour, it is the electrical energy consumed by an electrical appliance of power 1 kilowatt when it is used for 1 hour. 1 kilowatt hour is 3.6 into 10 raised to 6 joules. Now how you get 3.6 into 10 raised to 6 joules? See, kilowatt hour means 1000 and R 60 into 60. So 1000 into 60 into 60, it comes to 3.6 into 10 raised to 6 joules. That's how 1 kilowatt hour is equal to 3.6 into 10 raised to 6 joules. Now, household consumption of electricity, one unit is kilowatt hour. You know that. So energy is equal to power into time upon 1000. This is the way how you calculate. These are the two formulas. Sums are coming on this. Okay, so first formula which you use is energy is equal to power into time upon 1000. Power is VI. You can use either this formula or this one, VIT upon 1000. So cost is equal to electrical energy in kilowatt hour. This whatever answer you get for this energy that you take here, and cost per unit. Okay, then heating effect of current, that is Joule's law. The formula is H is equal to I square RT. Heat is directly proportion to square of current. Heat is directly proportion to resistance. Heat is directly proportion to time. Then 1 kilowatt hour is equal to 1 kilowatt is 1000 watt, 1 megawatt is 10 raised to 6 watt, 1 gigawatt is 10 raised to 9 watt. You have to remember this. Okay, now whenever you use any appliance or you buy any appliance from the market, they always give you like for example, if you buy a bulb, so on that bulb they give you the voltage and the watt. Okay, so if you have bought 100 watt bulb, okay, and the voltage is fixed in India, 220 volt is fixed in India. So 100 watt bulb means the power is 100 watt. So power is given, voltage is given. With the help of that, we can find out current and we can find out resistance. How can you find out current and resistance? Use the formula P is equal to VI. So power is 100, voltage is 220 into I. So I is equal to 100 upon 220. It comes to it comes to 0.454 ampere, or if you round it up, 0.5 ampere. And if supposing if you want to find out the resistance, use the formula V is equal to IR. So V we've got 220. I we just got this 5/11 into R. So R is equal to 220 into 11/5. It comes to 484 ohm. Just try this out, okay? So that's how with the when power is given and voltage is given and any appliance, you can find out the current and you can find out the resistance. Okay, now I'm going to give you one sum based on the electrical energy used. A bill, you have to calculate the bill for one person. Supposing there is one student of mine, her name is Mrugakshi. At her house, what all appliances are in use? Just note it down, bring me your notebook and write this down. So what all she uses at home? Suppose she is using 8 tube lights, 20 watt each for 8 hours, note it down. Then 4 fans, 50 watt each for 12 hours. Then 1 TV, 100 watt for 4 hours. 1 geyser, 500 watt for 2 hours. Now calculate the bill per month if the cost is rupees 8 per unit. So the electrical company, the cost per unit is 8 rupees. So then you have to calculate the bill for Mrugakshi. How much every month her bill will be there. Okay, so how do you solve a sum like this? So first of all, you make a table. Okay, so like for example, article you write. Then you write number of appliance. Then what. Then you write hours. Then you write what hour. Okay, so first article is tube light. Tube light. How many tube lights are there? 8. And what is 20 watt? It works for 8 hours. So when you multiply this all 3, it comes 1280. Okay, just multiply all this. That is watt hour. Then fan. How many fans are there? 4 fans are there. 50 watt. Working 12 hours. So when you multiply all of this, it comes 2400. Then TV is there. 1 TV. 100 watt. 4 hours working every day. Total watt hour is 400. Then geyser. 1 geyser. 500 watt. 2 hours. So watt hour is 1000. So total watt hour how much? Total watt hour is coming 5080. Then you are going to use this formula. Remember, energy is equal to power into time upon 1000. So energy is equal to power into time upon 1000. So energy is 5080. Time means number of days. Just remember that. Time is number of days. Here you have taken time already. That is number of hours used. Now number of days. Supposing it is 1 day. Supposing 15 days. So they can confuse you in the exam. So here time means number of days. So it is asked for 1 month. Na? So approximately we are taking 30 days. If they tell you particularly June month, July month and all, then accordingly you can take 30 days or 31 days. So 5080 upon 30 upon 1000. That comes to 152.40. So 152.40 is coming the energy used in kilowatt hour. So then cost. The cost will be, cost will be energy in kilowatt hour into cost per unit. So energy in kilowatt hour is 152.40 into cost per unit is rupees 8. So when you multiply 152.40 into 8, it comes to rupees 1219.20. So the amount which Mrugakshi has to give that particular month is rupees 1219.20. Okay, so they round it up. So maybe she has to pay 1219 rupees for that month. But you have to write this as the answer for your exam. So that's all in this lesson. Now these are just the sample sums we have done, two of them. Okay, there are many more sums related to current electricity. Now there will be a random marathon sums, all the textbook sums that will be in my part 2. So before that, you just go through all the theories, write them down, whatever you have studied in the link I have given in the description. I have given you the link, make a hard copy of the notes and go through all the notes. All right. And of course, if you have liked this video and if you have understood, please do not forget to share this video to your friends and to subscribe and send a like. Okay, and please let me know how you have understood in the box below, given below. Please share your comments. Okay, and let me know. Until then, see you. Bye bye.